Home bargains to open former City Toys R Us site. A huge new home bargain store is coming to Liverpool city centre and new jobs are set to be created as a result. The chain has got planning permission for a new shop in the old Toys R Us shop just north of the city centre with parking on site. According to documents submitted to the council, the Paisley Street shop will create 60 jobs. TJ Morris, who owns the chain, said the fact that it was taking over the empty building further demonstrates HB's commitment to its hometown. The move means Home Bargains will sit opposite Costco, which has had its store next door for years. Documents included with the application read, in keeping with its aspirations to be the discount retailer of choice, HB wants to completely refurbish the unit both externally and internally. This investment will exceed £1.5 million, but it will create jobs for local people through both the construction and operational phases, as well as facilitate the occupation of a vacant retail unit on Paisley Street. Up to 60 people will be employed in the retail unit, which is a substantial increase in employment. These new jobs are particularly significant at the current time when the retail sector is experiencing a structural change leading to the loss of many household names, including Toys R Us. The company bought the building after the collapse of Toys R Us last year meant the shop closed.
Now, there's a couple of events for you now that the weather's getting warmer and you might be feeling like going out a bit. First one is Opera Viva. It presents La Traviata, Verdi's colourful story of love and betrayal in Parisian high society. It's fully costumed and staged, and it's sung in English by Merseyside's award-winning amateur company. It's at Mossley Hill Church in Liverpool 18 on Friday the 12th of April at 7:30. Tickets are £15. It does have performances at other venues, so for tickets and information, phone 0151. 558 1552. And still in South Liverpool, the Walton Society have free talks. Wednesday the 17th of April at 7:30 we'll see John Hatfield speak on the Liverpool Overhead Railway, a much missed local landmark demolished in the 1950s. Talks are held in St Mary's Parish Hall off Church Road in Walton Village, and as I said, they are free to attend and they're open to all. Now back to singing, whether you want to take part or listen, this is for you. A choir from Waterloo are celebrating their continued growth and success after growing to more than 60 members and raising thousands for local causes. To support the restoration works of the church, including works to the organ, St Edmund's Choir has raised £4,000 through a series of concerts and events, in addition to continuing to be an inclusive, community-based choir. The choir, formed in 1997 by Martin O'Boyle, was started with just 4 people and now has a membership of more than 60, aged between 16 and 82. Members travel from as far as Kirby, Walton and Manchester to rehearse for a variety of events that take place over the course of the year, including concerts, quiz nights and more. Charlie Corkin, director of music, boasts the openness and inclusiveness of the choir. He says, there's no auditions, it's completely free, we don't charge our members anything. The choir enables people to come together because they love to sing, love to socialise and to support important causes. The choir's next concert, Musicals and More, will take place on Friday, June the 7th at 7:30 in the Crypt Concert Room at Liverpool Metropolitan Cathedral. Tickets are £10 and can be bought online at www.stedmundschoir.com. St Edmund's Choir welcomes anyone with a love of singing to their rehearsals each Sunday evening at 7 p.m. in the Lisbonian Room next to St Edmund's Church on Oxford Road, Waterloo, L22 8QF. So for more information, please email lovetosing@stedmundschoir.com or call 07730 413 024.
About ocean racing, which I'm sure none of us have done, but it's not plain sailing, even though our Lord Mayor thinks so. Liverpool is bidding to welcome the ocean race in 2021-22 after it was shortlisted to be the only UK host port. The event, considered as one of the world's longest and toughest races, takes place every 4 years and attracts 2.5 million live spectators and 2 billion strong TV audience. The elite of professional sailing will race around the world, visiting 6 continents over 8 months of sport. Now, out of more than 50 bids, Liverpool has been shortlisted and is in the running with 3 other European destinations to host the European finish of the transatlantic stage. If it is successful, Liverpool will welcome the fleet in 2022, when the race would stop over for more than 2 weeks. Mayor of Liverpool, Joe Anderson, said, "Liverpool is renowned for staging major outdoor events with a strong track record in maritime events, which shine an international spotlight on the city. Just a glance at our enviable annual events calendar showcases our ambitions, but we are always looking at new initiatives we are trying to bring here. Liverpool would have a huge amount to offer if we were successful in our bid to host the Ocean Race, and we understand that the event of this scale is an incredibly important catalyst for regeneration, investment, as well as raising the profile of sporting activities. To be shortlisted is a real reflection of the value Liverpool can add to this global sporting spectacle, and that we are a clear contender in this race. To mark the visit, there would be a programme of events, cultural activities, sustainability and business summits. There would also be sporting experiences to celebrate the arrival of this global exhibition of sailing prowess. World Borough Council is backing Liverpool's bid and would look at sharing hosting opportunities if the city is successful."
Headline starts, "Foolish nurse blew up his kitchen while trying to make cannabis oil." A foolish and frail nurse blew up his kitchen while trying to make cannabis oil to relieve his chronic spinal pain. Gary Holmes almost lifted the roof off his house while attempting to manufacture the Class B drug. The 58-year-old watched videos on YouTube for a DIY tutorial before packing cannabis plants and butane gas into 2 metal tubes. But the butane gas leaked, causing an explosion. Oh dear. Discovered inside the kitchen were 13 bags of cannabis with a street value of £10,350, prosecutors said. 33 cannabis plants were found, drying in the garage, equating to another £15,000. Holmes was found outside Semi on Heath Lane Croft near Warrington with minor burns. The explosion damaged the kitchen, with windows and brickwork being blown out. Luckily, his next-door neighbours were out and their home was undamaged. Holmes, who walks with a stick, claimed he grew cannabis solely for personal use and for pain relief, having injured his back 40 years ago. Jeremy Rawson, defending, said he took this step because he couldn't carry on and he embarked on his cavalier enterprise, taking this stupid risk. Prisons are for felons, not for fools. Holmes yesterday admitted arson, being reckless as to whether the life of another would be thereby endangered, and production of cannabis. Judge Neil Flewitt, QC, said, "Relatively recently, you reached a situation where you found the side effects of your prescribed medication to be intolerable, and you looked for an alternative. It was at that point that you took a wrong turn. It's only through good fortune you didn't cause damage to the adjoining property. Your neighbours have been charitable and forgiving, and you still have their trust. Although you didn't deliberately set out to cause this damage, you did deliberately grow cannabis, albeit for therapeutic reasons. I'm satisfied that you don't present a risk of danger to the public, and this was an isolated incident, one of which you've learned your lesson, and you will not be repeated. This is a highly unusual combination of circumstances, and on balance, the right cause is for me to suspend the sentence that would otherwise be imposed." Holmes was handed a 20-month prison sentence, suspended for a year.
A bit of boxing now. It says, Fowler to fight for British title. Now, Anthony Fowler has been ordered to fight for the British title in his next fight. The super welterweight already has a date in his diary and will take on former Team GB teammate Scott Fitzgerald at the end of the month. Fowler, 28, faces his fellow Commonwealth Games gold medalist in a tasty showdown on March the 30th at the M&S Bank Arena in Liverpool. If you're wondering what the M&S Bank Arena is, it's the Echo Arena with a new name. Anyway, March the 30th, M&S Bank Arena in Liverpool, exclusively live on Sky Sports in the UK and DAZN stateside. The fight will come as part of the supporting cast of former WBO world champion Liam Smith's matchroom boxing debut against Sam Eggington. But The Machine has been nominated by the British Boxing Board of Control as the next challenger to the Lonsdale belt that is currently held by Ted Cheeseman. Cheeseman, who beat Asinia Byfield for the belt back in October last year, was most recently soundly beaten in a challenge for the European belt against champion Sergio Garcia in February. Purse bids for the contest are due by April the 10th, and the fight must take place by the end of July.
This article is by Jasmine Cameron Chilish from The Echo, and it's entitled Dying Bride Just Wants Sick Dad to Walk Her Down the Aisle. It's quite a sad but uplifting story. A woman dying of cancer is hoping her terminally ill father can walk her down the aisle as her heartbreaking final wish. Toni Atherton has been battling cancer since she was 24, but on February the 4th this year was given the devastating news that her illness was terminal. 4 days later, her dad Derek Atherton was given the same diagnosis. Miss Atherton, who is now 27, said her dad from Liverpool continues to fight the effects of esophageal cancer and has been staying positive by preparing for the wedding. She told The Echo he's been Googling Father of the Bride speeches. It helps keep his spirits up. Toni Atherton, who grew up in West Derby and went to Broughton Hall School, was first diagnosed with ovarian cancer when she was 24 and then later diagnosed with vaginal cancer in 2017. In early February of this year, Miss Atherton was told that her cancer had spread and would eventually kill her. She said, "It has gone to my brain, my bones. It's everywhere at the minute. It's a very rare form of cancer." Shortly after her diagnosis, the family learned that Miss Atherton's 57-year-old dad was also terminally ill. She said, "His cancer is more aggressive than we thought. It has spread to his stomach, and so unfortunately he's not eating much at the minute." Tony's dad, Derek Atherton, told The Echo, "We were in shock, really, especially my wife. For the two of us to get it and for it to be both terminal, but we'll fight on." Tony's friends launched a GoFundMe campaign to help pay for some of the costs of her wedding, and it smashed the £1,000 target. Now the financial burden has been eased slightly. She says the family are praying her father gets to July. Miss Atherton and her fiancé, Jim Standen, who is 50, plan to marry on July the 26th. The couple have known each other for 5 years and met while working in a brain injury unit in Liverpool. They currently live in Widnes, where they care for Mr. Standen's parents, who have dementia. Although Tony and Jim have been planning their wedding for a while, the GoFundMe page was set up by Tony's friends Ashley Rosen and Jenny Douglas, who wanted to help the couple and the family in their time of need. Ashley said, "Tony is my best friend along with Jenny and Jim, and so when I heard the news about her and then also about her dad, I just felt really lost. We knew they were desperate to get married, and even more so now that Tony's dad was also ill, and so we thought it was the perfect idea. Neither of them wanted it at first because they didn't want to put anyone out. That's the kind of people they are. They just get on with life."
This headline starts, "I dragged myself up 14 flights as the lifts were broken. A man had to drag himself up 14 flights of stairs after lifts in his building were left broken for days. John Bird, who has multiple health problems that affect the use of his legs, said the incident at Wincraig left him screaming in agony. Mr. Bird said lifts in the tower in Stockbridge Village, where he has lived for 3 years, have been broken since last Friday. And he said that despite workmen coming to the block for a short period earlier in the week, the lifts were still broken. Mr. Bird said after the lifts appeared fixed, he left his flat and went out, but upon returning found the lifts not working again, and he had to climb the stairs despite having herniated discs and other problems with his bones. He said, I spent all night screaming in pain. I had to pull myself up the stairs. When I went out, the lifts had been working. He also said he was worried about other people with health problems being able to get out of the tower. Villages Housing Association, which runs the building in Knowsley, says one of the lifts is now fixed and a manager apologises to tenants in the tower. Director of Neighbourhoods Martin Haig said one of the lifts is back in service and we're working to get the other lift repaired as quickly as possible. We have been in constant contact with all tenants living in the block to offer as much assistance as we can. We apologise for any inconvenience caused.
This is past life from the Echo, looking back at our city's rich history. And it's about the fatal fire that left cruise liner a burnt out hulk in Gladstone Dock. Nothing seemed out of the ordinary when the liner Empress of Canada steamed into Liverpool's Gladstone Dock on Saturday, January the 10th, 1953. The 20,000-ton ship had returned to her home port for a routine winter overhaul before resuming service with an Atlantic crossing on February the 11th. But it was a voyage the Empress was never going to make. On the evening of Sunday, January the 25th, fire raged through the superstructure of the Canadian Pacific Steamship Company vessel. Fire crews from across the northwest raced to Gladstone No. 1 branch dock to try to contain the blaze, but it was all in vain. The ship gradually started listing and eventually rolled over on its side on the dock bottom, a charred and burnt out hulk. As first light came, the desolation was plain to see. Half the ship from bow to stern was visible as it completely blocked the deep water berth. Salvage work started quickly as the dock space was badly needed. Masts and funnels had to be cut away and the ship righted so it could be towed away. More than a year later, on Saturday, March 6, 1954, salvage crews were ready to bring the Empress back on an even keel. It was a huge operation. The water level in the dock had been reduced to 24 feet before 16 massive cables pulled up the submerged port side. At the same time, six pontoons, each weighing more than 100 tons, dragged down the exposed starboard side. Buoyancy floats filled with compressed air returned the ship to an angle of 9 degrees as it rested on the dock bottom. It took 10 more weeks to patch the hull and refloat the Empress for the final voyage to the breakers yard in the Italian port of La Spezia. The hulk was towed out of Liverpool on September the 1st, 1954, by the 836-ton tug Zwarte Zee. It is estimated that the salvage operation cost the Mersey Docks and Harbour Board £466,000, as well as blocking the deep sea berth for 18 months. A court of inquiry in March 1954 ruled that the probable cause of the blaze was a cigarette discarded in a cabin. The fire was first discovered at 4:10 p.m. It was a sad end for a proud ship. The Empress was launched as the Duchess of Richmond in June 1928. It served as a troop ship in World War II and carried 3,700 Russian prisoners back to Odessa from France in March 1945. The ship was renamed the Empress of Canada in 1947 and made her first post-war commercial voyage from Liverpool to Quebec on July the 16th the same year. Like a phoenix rising from the ashes, a new Empress of Canada was launched in 1960. The liner made its maiden voyage from Liverpool to Montreal on April the 24th, 1961. The 27,000-ton liner completed 121 transatlantic voyages and 82 cruises for the Canadian Pacific Line before her final docking at Liverpool on November the 23rd, 1971. The Empress was sold to Carnival Cruise Lines in January 1972 and renamed the Mardi Gras. After a number of further name changes operating under different cruise lines, the ship was eventually scrapped in 2003 after 42 years in service.
This is about indoor fun. A 200-foot long inflatable obstacle course is coming to Liverpool after being added to the lineup for indoor funfair. Energizer was enjoyed by thousands of children when it toured the UK last year. However, this will be the first time it has been to Liverpool. The indoor funfair will be taking over Liverpool's exhibition centre during the Easter holidays from April the 15th to the 22nd. It will give families unlimited access during each three-hour session to more than 20 favourites, including the Waltzers, Funhouse, Ghost Train and the Cherroplane Swing Ride. Recently added to the list of attractions are two mini coasters, a huge inflatable slide and a 3D experience zone, along with rides specifically for younger children. John Lowry from Indoor Funfair said, "We're thrilled to be bringing a section of the world's longest continuous inflatable obstacle course to Liverpool for the first time."
Driver's pals deliver a message on mental health. The workmates of a train driver involved in a tragic fatality on the tracks shared an important message to anyone struggling with their mental health and promised to rally round their colleague. The Virgin train service from Liverpool Lime Street to London Euston collided with the victim near to Mossley Hill Station at 8:30 a.m. on Sunday. The Echo understands the victim was unconscious on the tracks after falling from the bridge on Rose Lane when the train hit. British Transport Police confirm the death is not being treated as suspicious. The driver was given medical attention for shock and distress by paramedics, as is standard practice in a train collision. Commenting on the Echo website, a colleague of the driver said, "The driver is one of my workmates. We'll all rally round him and make sure he's all right. A big thank you to all of you out there for showing care and compassion to him. It means a lot to us. You'll also find all of us will have the most utmost sadness for what this poor person has done to themselves to think life ain't worth living. We see it all far too often. People, please don't be big and strong if you are suffering like this. Someone, you need to speak to someone exactly, tell them exactly how you are. Samaritans, mates, family, anyone, they will all help you." A spokesman said at 8:33 a.m. officers were called to Mossley Hill Station after reports of a casualty on the tracks. Paramedics also attended, however a person was sadly pronounced dead at the scene. Officers are now working to inform the person's family. This incident is not currently being treated as suspicious and a file will be prepared for the coroner. Northwest Ambulance Service said an ambulance rapid response vehicle and hazardous area response team vehicle has been deployed to the scene, but no one was taken to hospital. The Echo's Liverpool FC correspondent, James Pearce, was on the train along with hundreds of Red fans travelling to London for the away fixture against Fulham when the collision occurred. He said it was only a few seconds after we left the station and the train ground to a pretty abrupt halt. It's quickly apparent became apparent that the train had hit a person. Then the staff told us that there had been a fatality and paramedics came on board. We were also told the driver was so distressed he was receiving medical treatment from the paramedics. Virgin Trains declined to comment on this incident.